relationship. Then we talk about that. I said that when this was written, 787 didn't exist. So it existed on paper. There were actual descriptions of what it is. There were technical specifications, but the plane itself didn't exist. I also told him that we really should think of it in terms of the implementation in the database. So what you see here are different entities. So there is an entity of planes, and instances of those and of that entity will be actual planes, physical planes described in the database on the right hand side. On the left hand side, it's an instance of a plane type. I'm sorry, the entity of a plane type. And an instance of the type entity will be a description of the type. Nicholas, she is making progress. She's on the 2 minutes late for this class.
Well, 3 minutes late for my class, 2 minutes late for this.
We're talking about employees. Employees can be of different kinds, right? And this is what we represent by using a type of employee. So when we describe our policy that we're going to have employees of this type, so like salesperson, cashier, and buyer, in the policy plane, so there will be this entity employee type. So an entity will correspond to a table, a relational database. Instances of an entity will be records in that table. So in this case, the instances of the plane type will be salesperson, cashier, and buyer. And there we have some attributes describing those types of employees. So there will be the name, there is some kind of description of responsibilities, basically. So those are records describing the types of the employees. But at the operational level, our entity employees will have instances, particularly employees. Actually, descriptions of human beings who are employed there. And there we actually say, okay, but those types, they really, actually, they all generalize for those generic type employee, but each one is an entity in and of itself. So there's an entity of salesperson, some instances of those entities with a particular salespeople. And they told you that actually the only thing special about this is that actually, the primary key, which is the identifier of records, will be the same. If we use, I don't know, the employee ID as the primary key in the employees table, then it's going to be the same primary key in each of these subtype tables. And the only thing is that we will also define the primary key as a foreign key, as I said. That for you to relate to all this, you really have to understand some basic things about relational databases. If you don't, then it's difficult to understand the foreign this whole discussion. But we are talking about actually a set of tables. I don't know also that, you know, why do we need separate tables for these subtypes of employees? And usually the only reason to have those separate tables is if we need special attributes to describe those employees. Right? So here there is an example saying that the type of employees buyers, so when we describe buyers, it requires a special attribute credit limit, which doesn't apply to any other employee. If we added this attribute to the general employee table, for most of the types of employees who are not buyers, there would be no value in this attribute. Or in the language of relational databases, we would have to say that this particular attribute will have a lot of so-called nulls, null values, which is nothing. By the way, it's not a zero. No, don't get an idea that null refers to a zero. Null refers to nothing. Okay? Not present, omitted. Okay? And actually, nulls are tricky in relational databases because if people don't clearly understand what they're doing, if it involves operating on records that have nulls, say certain things, certain queries may produce results unexpected by inexperienced users. So this is the reason why when we're talking about pooling information together in relational tables, we use the so-called joins, the joint tables together. So in the early days, people only you expect. Another problem is that the meaning of joints differs from situation to situation. It's a semantic joints. Okay? So there is a difference between an absent value because it is not known, but the value exists somewhere. A value which is not currently known, but may be known sometime in the future. Okay? And the case where the value is not there because it is not applicable. Okay, so if you look at this table describing students, and you have an attribute in that table, which is the ID of the dissertation advisor, okay, then in the case of undergraduate students, there is no value there because this field is not applicable. Undergraduate students write dissertations. Okay, so that's why it is not there, because it's not applicable to the undergraduate students. If you are dealing, say, with doctoral students, and if a student in his or her first 2 years of study, there is no value there because that doctoral student has not decided yet, okay, on the identity of the dissertation advisor. And there are other cases where, okay, we may not just know what the value is, whatever it is, even though the value must exist somewhere. So all that is tricky, we don't want nuts. So it would be a bad idea to take this attribute, credit limit, and put it in the general employee table. It is much better to create a separate table for the subtype so that this field is meaningful for all the instances in the table. So similarly, for the salespersons, you may want another field called the commission rate. So you see a lot of salespeople work on commission in addition to their regular salary. So that the commission rate would be applicable only to salespeople, but not to any other employee. So that's the reason why we want to have these separate instances. So what it means is, again, in the relational database, the employee table will have a description, will have records for all the employees identified by their ID and their general attributes, like name, social security number, address, date of birth, telephone number, so on and so forth, right? While these tables will have only subsets of those, right? And only just with the ID identified and the collectors. So this is what you have at the operational level. And as I said, at the policy level, you will have just a description of the type. So, for example, the description specifies the base pay rate. So, the employee of this type should not be paid any less than that one. So, grouping represents a kind of association. So, we put things together. And again, I believe that we discussed this. So, for example, if we have a description of the pay. Particular plane at the operational level, at the policy level, we can have a grouping of the planes referring to a free. Okay? Now, when we do this, when we put multiple planes together, these groups usually have certain attributes which are based on the current membership in the group. For example, the total number of members in the group. Or as we would say, the cardinality of the set. Okay? So you define a fleet like here. Okay? And one of the attributes of the fleet is the number of planes in that fleet. Now you see a forward slash in front of that attribute, right? In the description. So this table describing fleet. So and a record in that table will describe a particular fleet, right? For example, American Airlines. And so there are fields that just say the owner, the maintenance provider, whatever. But there is this number of planes. So what is special about it, and why does it have a forward slash? Well, because it is really determined by the records in the table planes. So we have two separate tables. One describes physical planes, and the other one describes groupings of those planes into fleets. Okay? And the relationship is this grouping relationship, basically saying that this plane belongs to that fleet. So this is a one-to-many relationship. It means that so when it is implemented in the relational database, this table plane will have the fleet ID at it that will establish this relationship, right? So when we describe the plane, we will put in that attribute the ID of the fleet the plane belongs to. Okay, again, basic relational databases, how you implement one-to-many relationships, you just add a shared attribute, right? So a fleet ID will be added to the plane table to represent this relationship. So all the planes, all the records in the plane table, which belong to a certain fleet, will determine the number of planes in the fleet. So you simply need to count them. So this is an example of the so-called derived attribute. Strictly speaking, any information that can be derived should be derived. That's the basic philosophy of databases. You don't want to store any redundant information. Why? Because it can potentially result in inconsistencies. Right? So therefore, looks like it is not a good idea to store it. Why do we do it? Well, because if it is used often, but if it changes infrequently, then it would not be worth our while to keep recalculating this number over and over and over again whenever we need to use it. So yes, it is a derived number. Okay? And yes, if we store it in a database, there is a potential for inconsistency. So if we decide to go this route, and this is then there is a trade-off. The trade-off is that we have to put the safeguards in that make sure that whenever any information changes, so when can it change? Say if a record is added or removed from the plain table. So because that can potentially change the count. So we have to make sure we have certain procedures in the database, operating on the database, that will make sure that the count will be updated appropriately whenever it has to be updated. And there are things in relational databases, even in the old days, there were some triggers in relational databases that could be used to trigger a change and make sure that the field is kept up to date. So again, so this is an example of a trade-off. And grouping abstractions, usually, very often, will have a number of those derived attributes. The other one shown there is the actual average age of planes. Okay, so for example, a fleet may decide that we want to have planes on average not older than, okay, say 5 years, or maybe, I don't know, 10 years, okay, so the age of a plane, you know, as with any mechanical things, so machines age, and it becomes older, and it's not really important. So here again, the actual average age can be calculated because the age of the plane, because the acquisition date, right? Assuming that you're buying two planes, for every plane, you can calculate the age of that plane. You have the record of all the planes in a fleet. You can retrieve it. Calculate the average speech. Again, so that's a derived attribute. So this is an example of this grouping construction. And you see it has, usually it is associated with a fair number of derived attributes. And as I said, so we keep those that we don't really update them often, but we use all of them. Okay, because if we don't keep them, then whenever we use them, we have to calculate the things. Any questions? Okay, so this is just a summary of difference between these two abstractions. So Deprecation is a kind of, Rubin is a member, right? So deprecation is a power type. So in the sense that it has instances of types or that are subtypes, as we saw there on the example. Now, derived aggregates, usually we don't deprecations and the common deprecations. Deprecations are transitive. So, the plane is of 747 type and 747 is a jet, then our plane is a jet, right? So, this is what transitivity means. So, we derive the transitivity. But with groupings, it's not really the case. So, if a plane is in, say, a fleet of United, and United is in the Star Alliance, a plane cannot be considered to be in the Star Alliance because Star Alliance consists of airlines, not planes. Okay, so again, it may sound like nitpicking, particularly because you see those, and you will see the Star Alliance sign actually shown on the plane, on the fuselage, displayed. But strictly speaking, it is shown there because the plane belongs to the airline. It's a member of the Star Wars, but the plane itself is not. Okay, here's an example of a hybrid definition where a type is used for grouping. So this is also possible. Okay, if, for example, you define, say, fleet by the type of the planes. So let's say a manufacturer decides to have people who are monitoring the fleets of all the planes of produced so far of a certain kind. So if a plane is, I don't know, 737, belongs to this fleet. So at this stage, you know, it has, we have this entity at the policy level that has characteristics of both. So it has attributes describing the type, and it has attributes describing the group at the same time. And this happens because we decided to group by type. So it's possible. So whenever we decide to group by type, then our association that we have here will be of both types. It will be both a typing association and a grouping association. And therefore, typically, we'll have the attributes, characteristic of both. Okay. Any questions? As a derived, as I said, typifications usually don't use derived attributes. Derived attributes are used for in groupings. Because when you do typification, you describe the type. It will apply to every instance of that type. So it, as I said, so you have a particular airplane. But we say the type of this airplane is 737-800, right? So you will have the physical characteristics. So when you describe the type, you will have, for example, all the physical characteristics of the type. The number of engines, the length of the airplane, the maximum seating capacity, all those types that describe that particular type. There are no derived characteristics, so those are attributes which stand on their own. You cannot derive them from anywhere. You have to know what they are to describe them particular type. But if you say, okay, so I actually consider a group of all 737-800s, then it makes sense to talk about derived attributes like the number of planes in this group, the average age of planes in this group, and so on and so forth. So those are derived attributes. A group is a set of objects. And therefore, you can have attributes which you derive from the descriptions of all those objects. Any other questions?
Okay. Now, in some cases, it makes sense to have only the definition of a type without the definition
at the operational level. So a prototypical example is cars versus nails. So think about that. So if you have to describe what you have in your inventory, for example, you are a car dealership, right? So you will have certain physical cars in your inventory. Those cars need to be described. So there will be their IDs, you know, that there is some configuration number. So that would be a unique identifier of the car, a physical car. And then there will be some other parameters, for example, describing how the car is packaged. But then there will be types. For example, you, I don't know, you have Toyota Camrys, 2020 Toyota Camrys in your inventory. 2020 Toyota Camry is a type, right? But those specific Toyota Camrys that you have in your inventory can be packaged differently. I'm not on top of what is going on today with Toyota Camry, but in the old days, we used to have certain Camrys with a 4-cylinder engine and certain Camrys with a 6-cylinder engine. I don't know if that's still the case, or they now switch to some kind of other thing, but my guess is that probably yes. Therefore, when you describe a particular Toyota Camry, you have to specify what kind of an engine it has. Because Toyota Camrys went from different engines, right? But what you have at the policy level, you have just a general description of the car, right? For example, the fuel capacity tank is the same, right? So now I can say 16 gallons, 15 gallons, 15 gallons, same for Toyota Camrys. On the other hand, let's say we have nails. I don't know, particular type, like you don't know. Roofing nails, other types. Now, if we try to represent them exactly the same way as we represent the parts, then we should have a description of the type of nail. I don't know, 2-inch roofing nail, right? So that's the type of a nail. That's a description of the type. Here, we would have a description of a particular nail. For example, the type says 2 inches. But if you measure it, it may be 2.02. And the other one would be 1.99. Okay, so there may be some variations because the standard is not perfect. And then the question comes up. Why do you want to do this? Does it really matter? Do you really want to keep track of every individual nail? By the way, to be able to do that, somehow you have to engrave a serial number on that nail. Because otherwise, you would not be able to tell which nail is which. So you have to actually to be able to tell the difference between different nails of the same type. Who would want to do this? I can tell you that Home Depot would not. Okay, so they definitely don't do this. So therefore, what they have this so-called compromise definition called nail type. This is very interesting because when we are talking about it, so if we are talking about this is kind of a type of definition because it's both a description of the type and a description of the group, right? So in both cases, so we have the right attributes. By the way, QOH, for those who are not used to this kind of stuff, is the acronym that stands for quantity on hand. Okay, so if you see this, QOH stands for quantity on hand. So how many we have? So here, the derived attributes, why? Because we have records at the operational level and we can count how many of records of that type we have. Now, if we say, well, you know, we don't really care to distinguish between individual nails, the only thing we want to know is how many of those nails we have in stock. we still actually need this attribute quantity on hand. But you see that the slash disappears. Why did it disappear? So why do we have slash or slash in the nail type on the left, but we don't have it on the right? Correct. So on the left, it's a derived attribute. If we keep track of individual nails, we go to the table and we count the records. On the right, there is nothing to count. You cannot derive the value of that attribute from anywhere else. Okay, so this is where you keep it. So this is your inventory. So when we have those nail type items in the inventory, we inevitably will use those compromised definitions where we don't actually have individual descriptions of individual items. There is no reason for us to. You know, there may be situations where items like nails may be tracked individually. I don't think they use any nails in spaceships, but they definitely use nuts and bolts. And I'm pretty sure that those things are tracked individually. Yeah.
But would you normally count the number of nails or packages? That's the
yeah, thing this is for the sake of an example.
Yeah.
Sure. That you can talk about boxes.
Yeah.
For nails. Yeah. So this it depends on how you do your inventory tracking. So but this is a prototypical example where you show that for certain types of standard items, you just keep track of the quantity of the item basis. So 2-inch nails versus 3-inch nails. In reality, yeah, we're going to have different, as they say, SKUs, stock keeping units for different packages. Any questions? Yeah.
You said it was a category. The 2020 attribute of a hero production model. Is that too specific for a type?
Good question. And the answer is you could make it an attribute value if you in the type name, can you just make it another attribute?
So
basically, your question is whether you should put 2020 in the name, or you just separate it out as an attribute.
Over time, I would like to have the, like to run query that I would have all types of CEO test.
You may be right on that. I'm trying to see if there is any potential issue. I think that's actually doable. So we just separate. But then, actually push it even further.
Yeah.
You can say that actually Toyota and Camry should be two separate attributes. So you would have manufacturer, model.
Yeah.
Okay. And the only thing is that in this case, in that car type attribute, your primary key will consist of three attributes. So it's going to be a composite primary key, because otherwise it's not going to be a unique identifier. So you can actually split it in different things, some part of the puzzle. At least, at the top of my head, I don't see any problem with this. It seems to be okay. Any other questions? Okay. As far as the types are concerned, we can actually go from types to super types. So we can have what is called stratification. And the example on the paper talks about plane types and plane categories. Okay. For example, when we're talking about plane types, we'll be talking about 737, 747, and so on. When we're talking about plane categories, so say categories can be jet planes and propeller planes. Okay. So those would be the examples of the categories. And vibrational level, we just have planes and flights. Right? Physical plane and the particular flight. So when we're talking about flight types, we might be talking about, say, flights New York to Chicago. So that's a flight type. But a particular flight number, which leaves on a certain day, at a certain time, that is a specific flight. Right? So that particular flight will be reported in this table, but the flight type, that this is just a New York to Chicago flight, will be recorded in the flight type table. So what will be a route type? So a route type in this case can be, say, domestic or international. And we'll talk about, you see that they're talking about, so what is the relationship between planes and flights? So here we will record what actually happens. So what particular plane was used to serve a particular flight? Here we can talk about the airline policies. So when we're talking about plane types, and say flight times, for example, we can say that New York to Chicago should be served by Boeing 737. And so we don't really want to use 747 flights from New York to Chicago. And there may be multiple reasons why they decide to do it like that. For example, they want to have multiple flights at different times by business reasons, a huge plane flying. And at the top, we can have a different kind of a policy. We can say that, for example, if we're dealing with international flights, we should allow only jet planes to be used for those flights. So propeller planes can be used for some domestic flights, but as far as international flights are concerned, we should really allow only that. Those associations that we represent here both represent our policy. Again, keep in mind, all these entities will correspond to tables and databases. Those particular types and supertypes will be instances of those types and supertypes will be records. And we will express our policies through these declarative means. We will simply describe them in our database. So this is the whole point. This paper showing the structure of policy descriptions in modern information systems, which are all based on relation databases. Any questions? Mechanisms. So, as I said, so we have three types of policies: knowledge intensive descriptions, validation rules, and target descriptions. And we have three mechanisms. By the way, there's not one to one because different types of policies, the same type of policy can be described. So different mechanisms, okay? But there are three different mechanisms. And by mechanism, we call attributes, associations, and association classes. So attributes will define a certain characteristics of concepts. Will be applied to inference. So for example, a particular type of items should be sold this amount of money. So this is specified at the policy level. Then the sale price can be inferred if we have an association between the item and the type of the item. So association rules, association define interactions, valid and invalid. So we can have an association and say that, okay, only certain things which are in this association will be allowed to do it. For example, we can have an association between categories of flights and categories of planes. And we'll see that the category of international flights is associated only with jet planes, and it is not associated with propeller planes. So this is represented in the database, and this is declaration of our policy. And finally, we have association classes. So what is an association class? It's basically an association which also has attributes that describe it. Not all associations need attributes, but in some cases, we can have attributes in associations. Right? So in that case, we'll have a special table describing this association, and it will be will not only have the composite primary key, but it will also have some known key attributes which describe the associations. So here, for example, this can be used to define, say, targets. Which may not be exactly the case because the actual fuel consumption may depend on some particular things and may deviate from the slightly our expectation. So you'll see that. So now, okay, so we have different policies, different types of policies, different mechanisms to implement those policies, and these two categories of associations, simplification. So what comes next is different ways how we can represent these policies. Now, what do you see on the slide? So the black rectangles are entities. So those entities are shown both at the operational level and policy level. And then you see connections between the entities, which are either solid or dotted or broken. Broken or dotted connections represent either typifications or groupings. That we use to describe our associations. Non-broken ones will not be. And then you can see, but where there are certain things which are shaded. Okay, so you see this shaded, which is represented. Okay. So this is the actual policy description. So in the basic pattern, you see that it is actually described by the attributes of the policy entity, right? And then you see different associations, which are shaded. So this is where they represent policies, right? And we have these patterns. By the way, this is not exhaustive. We'll talk later, there is this heuristic nature of this pattern. So this is only what most commonly happens. So we will see when we actually create a model, a semantic model of our system, then you will see that these things, they appear often, right? Basically, they're compromised, right? Okay, so, and here there is this extensive example where you see all those different kinds of patterns that we categorized on the previous slide. Now, all designates operational level. So these are, when you see an O, it tells you that this is an entity at the operational level, right? So you don't see it. T and G correspond to the entities at the policy levels, which represent either typifications or groupings. Okay? And then you see different patterns. For example, as we discussed before, so there is this entity of flights and the entity of flight types that we represent in our information system. Again, think about the tables. Okay, so there will be a table describing where the records describe individual flights, and then will be another table called flight types where the records describe different flight types. Okay. And a basic pattern. So here we have the attribute scheduled departure time, right? Scheduled departure time, this is basically a target description. So we want the departure time to be this. Now, in reality, as unfortunately most of you have experienced, the actual departure time will be different, right? And maybe it's another factor. So this is where we basically can see how we. So this is the target description. So this is our policy. We want to be part of this type, but in fact, we be part of this type, right? And we can actually, after we have multiple records, we can actually evaluate our level of compliance. This policy by doing the calculations to see on the average how much we deviate on the outcome. Right? So another example is, that we have a policy which describes targeted fuel consumption for different flight types using different planes, plane types. Okay. So
So what is this? So this is an association between flight time and plane time. The objective of this association, again, to represent our target description, right? So in this case, we use a different mechanism. If in the previous case that we discussed, the mechanism was the attribute, right? To represent this policy. The policy, the kind of the policy is the same, it's the target description. But the mechanism that we use is different. So in this case, the mechanism was the attribute. Here, the mechanism is an association class. Why? Because targeted consumption is an attribute of association between flight types and plane types. Again, thinking about relational databases, you will realize that, that this association is actually, okay, it's a many-to-many relationship, so there will be a table representing this relationship. That table will have a composite primary key consisting of the flight type ID and plane type ID, and targeted fuel consumption will be one of the attributes of this association and will be represented in this table, right? So well, there will be a record for every flight type and every plane type, and one of the attributes described will be the targeted. It's a target, and the here is represented by the association class. Okay? And so we can keep going. There are a lot of other patterns here, right? So you can see other things. So for example, there is a compromised pattern. For example, we have cancellation times, right? So we go directly to this level, which is above the flight time and plane time, right? So, and for the cancellation time, you know, our association with route type describe different verbs. For example, if the route is international and the cancellation due to mechanical failure, the verbs, for example, may include covering the hotel, covering the lodging. While if the flight is domestic and the cancellation type is the same, okay, but it's a different route type, then we may not actually include a large expense in the verbs. Okay, so again, so this is an example of how we describe different policies. So what is common in all this? That there is absolutely no procedural element here. So the policies I explained expressed purely in declarative terms. Okay, now this is where they talk about the so-called implicit nature. So look at this example. So this is our operational level. So we have entities of pilots, entities of flights, and entities of planes. The association that we have is actually pilots are assigned to a particular flight. And planes are assigned to a particular flight. So this is here, we have this pattern which looks very similar to the hybrid pattern. The hybrid pattern, we have a direct association at the operational level. So this is so there is this entity at the policy level, and here this operational entity also is associated. And this is where the policy description takes place. Now here, when we look at the actual, that we see that there is no direct association. There is this thing in the middle. But what is our policy? Our policy is to use the pilots which are qualified for that plane type. As a matter of fact, it's not even, I mean, it has to be a policy because, you know, the regulatory bodies actually require that. People, I think people who go to jail, they die violent. So No airline pilot will agree to fly a plane that the airline pilot has no qualification for, because you know you have to be qualified. You have to spend a certain number of hours in a flight simulator, and there are for that particular plane. So here we have an association. So what is this association? Again, so this table is a table of pilots. Then we have a table of lifetimes. Again, this is a many-to-many relationship. It means that it will be represented by a table. In this case, okay, for the sake of the argument, we can say that this table has no other attributes. So this is an all-key table. So every record of the table consists just of a composite primary key. Plane type and the pilot ID. Plane type ID and the pilot ID. Okay, and it can say that 737-800, that's the plane type. And the pilot ID. If that record is present, it means that the pilot is qualified. And therefore, this is a valid assignment. This pilot can be assigned to this flight if 737-800 is also assigned to this flight. So when we make these assignments, we actually have to check if we have those records that express the qualification, right? So in this case, it's just the existence of the record in the relationship table. In reality, there will be additional attributes, for example, the expiration. Usually those qualifications may have some expiration dates assigned. So that may be one of the non-key attributes in the table. But this discussion, what is important is that we have this association table representing this many-to-many relationship between pilots and plane types. And whenever these two assignments are made, a particular pilot is assigned to a flight, the plane is assigned to that flight. We have to check that our pilot is qualified for that plane type, so we have to trace the certification association, see what is the type, right? And then check the table to see if the record is there that specifies that this particular pilot is qualified to fly the record. That's type. As I said, in this case, so we are dealing with this hybrid thing. Here we are dealing with one entity, which is at the policy level, that has an association, which is not a typification of grouping. So this is not a typification of grouping, right? These are just assignments. So these associations at the operational level are not of the typification of grouping type, right? And this association is not a typification of grouping, because this is just a qualification. So this is an example of a policy which uses what looks like a different pattern. But this pattern is similar to this hybrid. Right? So in a way, if you understand that these five, these are the simplest patterns that they can identify, then you can easily figure out that you can do it this way. Any questions? Yes. Maybe for something else, but in this particular case, you know, those qualifications on an individual by individual basis. But you can say that you can have pilot types. Pilots, I don't know. No, we have individual driver licenses, and we have commercial driver licenses. Well, I suppose if you're dealing, I don't know, with military pilots, you can talk about, say, categories of fighter pilots, or bomber pilots, or that kind of stuff. That you make a rules. Yeah, I mean, you can, but in this particular case, we don't need to use a type of pilot for the expression of the policy. No, it is based on the substance of your case. It's based on the business reality, so what you're trying to describe. It is based on what kind of policies you're trying to describe. In this particular case, it so happens that, so we do have this policy, right? That only qualified pilots have can fly to airplanes, right? No, when we design, the system is designed to support an operation of business. So when you're designing the system, so you have to think about which policies you put in place, and it will determine what kind of entities you have to create to model those policies in your system. So this is the data modeling principle. So in the same way that when we did just pure breed RNA, and we talked about this operational level, so we had to see what kind of things we needed to describe, what kind of resources we had, what kind of events happened, what kind of agents. So here we have to think about what kind of policies we want to implement in our enterprise. And then, based on that, we will create a description of those policies in our system using the needs that the authors propose in this paper. So some specific guidance for RAA. So basically, the same way that RAA actually provided more specific guidance for utilization of generic anti-relationship model. So here, when they talk about this, they say, so what can we say? So in RAA, we know that we have the entities of resources, events, and agents. Can we say anything more specific about the kind of typifications and groupings we should expect to use? And just to reiterate, keep in mind that this is not normative. I can tell you. So RAA was kind of normative because it had to do with the kind of business. So basically, model and value creation, exchanges, transfers, and transformations. But here, I mean, policies can be anything, right? It's really up to those people who are the business. So, but what they say typically, we will want to use particular type of applications and groupings, and it will allow us to represent these policies in a very succinct way. So, as far as resources, events, and agents are concerned, so when we try to typify, so categorize, so resources, types of resources, will basically correspond to the different technical specifications. So, for example, as I say, one of your resources may be fuel, right? And different types of fuel, say if we're talking, I don't know, gasoline, can be regular, super, or things like that, right? So those would be the types. So events are categorized on their mode of execution. So if we're talking about so how events are sales, what kind of types of sales we're going to have? So they say, well, we can have sales with distributors, we can have direct physical sales, we can have online sales. Those are different types of sales. So this is about the identification of events. And when we're talking about the identification of agents, so we can qualify them, typify them based on their qualifications. So, for example, very important to customers or quality of vendors. So, customers at the highest credit rate, customers at the intermediate credit rate. Right? So, we can talk about different types of customers. Why? Because it would be useful to have different policies for those customers. Right? So, if you have a highly credit worthy customer, and I don't know, this customer is late, maybe with payment, maybe your company policy is that you're not going to be as harsh as compared to a customer with very low credit worthiness, where your policy has to be the first late payment you want to fund, right? So because there is a very high likelihood that the customer is going to default. Any questions? So this is about typifications of resources, events, and agents. What about the groupings? So So how do we group them? So we can do groupings of resources by type. Okay, so as we talked before, so very often, so we do use grouping by type. We can say group events by timing. It's a very typical thing for a business to group events by timing. For example, we have accounting periods and we have budgeted amounts which are defined by timing period, right? So it's convenient to group by time. And as far as policy definitions are concerned, again, sorry, to group events by time, not by time. Agents also can be grouped by their type. Okay, so let us consider some more specific examples of what we discussed before. We have a look at different policy definitions and we look at different patterns. And so here we look at a particular mechanism to express our policy. In this case, it's the app. So the value of the attribute of a policy instance will be used to express different kinds of policies. And in this case, we use a basic pattern. So what is the basic pattern? It means that there is an entity at the operational level on the right-hand side. There is an entity at the policy level, right, on the left-hand side. Here, for example, a typification abstraction. So basically, the entity on the left represents the type of the entity on the right. So let's say we're dealing with resources. So the entity on the right is a product, the entity on the left is a product type. Right? And we have this association, which is the relationship between the product and the product type. Right? And so so, other types can be described with their code. And then we can have attributes which describe their price, different colors that they can have, and their target weight. So, when we look at our policy, so what do we have here? The descriptions of the actual code. We have attributes which describe the actual weight, the color, and the price. Okay. Now, the price, according to our policy, has to be exactly the same as in the description of the type. For example, we don't negotiate, right? Let's say you're in Japan, right? You know, the Japanese don't negotiate. So everything sells. As I said, I have never been to China, but I understand that if you try to buy something in China, you don't negotiate. People will think that you're more. While in Japan, you want to buy something and you try to negotiate, people will be insulted. Either you need it or you don't need it. You want to buy it. By the way, how is it in Korea? Somewhere in between, right?
Yes. I think so.
So here, that's the price. Okay, so that's the right thing. Price has to be exactly the same. For the record of the time, there is a price that's available. So we put it there just as a matter of convenience. Often we don't know when it puts. Okay, so this is an example of a knowledge intensive description. It is what it is. So we describe it here, so we derive it. So when we actually, has to be one of the listed colors in the description of the type. Okay, so here, we're dealing basically with the validation. So we want to check, say that if the only available colors are, I don't know, green, yellow, and red, right, you cannot put orange in there. So this is the validation. So we have to verify that the color is important.
failure have a weight. So we do have a weight in the description of the product type, but that's just the target. The actual weight will be different. We know that it can be different, but with goal, but the variance of the target weight is not very big.
Yeah, we have examples of three different policies. And all of them are represented using the same mechanism, using attributes of our type, by using this type of association and this basic pattern, where one entity at the operational level, one entity at the policy level, and in this case, the typification association.
Okay, so let's look at another example. So here we have a different pattern. So we have a compromise. So our entity at the operational level is associated with two entities at the policy level, right? So we have an item category and a quality category. And our policy, our price, is expressed as an association class. So what does it mean that it is expressed as association class? It means that it is represented by the attribute of a relationship. So we have these two entities, quality category and item category, the database. And there is a many-to-many relationship called price policy. So this is going to be an additional table. So there will be a table describing quality categories. There will be a different table describing item categories. And there will be a separate table representing this many-to-many relationship. We'll have a composite primary key consisting of quality category ID and item category ID. And there will be a non-key attribute price. This attribute of the relationship, which will tell us what the price is supposed to be. This is, in this case, this is a derived property. So what kind of a policy is this? This is a knowledge-intensive description, because it tells us what the price is supposed to be. It's not just that we have to verify or it has to be approximately the target. This is the price. Okay, so this is a knowledge-intensive description policy, which is given using this association class mechanism applies to compromise one. Any questions about this example? How we do it? Okay? Okay, so imagine that we are dealing with a company that actually uses different transportation means to ship to different customers. Okay, so, and in conventional representations, so when you're showing it on paper, you have a table that gives you shipping decisions, right? So the company is probably located in the Midwest of the United States. So their policy is that we are shipping to customers who are also in the same region, Midwest. That we will either use trains or trucks. If we are shipping in, say, continental United States, then train may not be an option because the network is limited. You know, it will, may not be able to get everywhere to train. So therefore, our policy would be either to use trucks or to ship by plane. And if we are actually shipping overseas, then the only transportation options that we have are either plane or boat. So this is the table representing all the policies. So how do we actually represent it in our information system? So to represent it in our information system, we need to create these policy level entities called customer type and transportation type. And our particular customers will be of particular type and shipments will be of particular transportation type. So this is the operational level. At the operational level, we have particular customers and look at particular shipments and products to them. Right? So this is the association. Now, at the policy level, we have those two types. And the policy will be expressed using an association mechanism. So what does it mean? It means that we will create a relationship, a many-to-many relationship between the entity of customer type and the entity of transportation type. And whatever participates in the relationship, so will be our allowed policy. So in this case, they tell us basically what happens, but here it shows you what it will look like. So customer type will have three instances: Midwest, US, international. Transportation type will have four instances: truck, train, boat, and plane. Okay? And our association, so one table will have three records, so customer type will have three records. Transportation type will have four records. And this is basically the association that will represent our policy. So Midwest customers, truck or train, US customers, truck or boat, international customers, boat or plane. So it means that our relationship table will have six records. Right? So our relationship table, and again, relationship table will be just all key relationships. The primary key will be customer type ID and transportation type ID. It's a composite primary key. So we'll have six records. One will be Midwest truck, another one Midwest train. Then there will be US truck, US plane, international boat, international plane. So those would be the records in the relationship table. Okay? So this is what we'll have in the database. So what we will have in the database? Yes.
Basically, there is a very limited number of carriers that direction of time. So therefore, there is actually no reason for us to create carrier types. And when you are dealing with certain things where you have very, very few instances, usually it will be pointless to consider different types of carriers. For example, in this case, you can say that one is a state pole and another one is a commercial carrier. But why would you, if you're talking about policies, then express them directly? So if we are talking about different shipment types, then we can express the participation policy directly. Again, mechanism of civil association. Okay, so there are other things. So here you see this root one, employee type and project team, right? So here it's the same employee, right? But it can be of a certain type, and therefore it can only be assigned to a certain project team if that type is approved for that team, right? And again, we will have this relationship which describes what type can be approved for which kind of needs, right? So which describes the policy. So here an example of a very important bill of material. So what is the bill of material? The bill of material is a technical specification of the product. So basically when you are manufacturing a product, you really have to specify exactly what kind of, say, raw materials, sub-assemblies is needed to assemble one unit of the product, and in what quantity. And when you do this bill of material, this bill of material is really specified. So it is also a policy specification. So you can say that this is a technical specification, yes, but it is also our business policy to create these products. So you can view a bill of material as a type of policy. Okay, by the way, it's a very important concept in enterprise systems. So when you do, so here we have at the operational level, we have description of the actual raw materials and actual finished goods. But then at the policy level, we have the types of those materials, right? So a particular material is a particular raw material that we got. It will be of a certain type, and the finished good would be of a certain type. And here we will have this relationship. So this relationship between types raw material and types of finished goods will describe our bill of material. Now, this will necessarily be an association class. It cannot be just an association because quantities are critical. So we not just describe that this type of material is used for this product, but we have to describe in what kind of quantities. And it means that we need non-key attributes describing that relationship, right? So describing this relationship, they will be describing this raw material, right? And other. So when we can use this, for example, to keep track of cost. So there is this standard cost, and there is the actual cost. So this is directly out of, you know, cost account. So and here you see that in this case, this target description, right, will be used to calculate the variance. So when you are actually making your actual finished goods, you can calculate how much your actual cost will deviate from the cost that you describe as your policy, right, which is the cost, the standard cost of that of those ones. So here again, bill of material is an example of a target description. That's the type of the policy. The mechanism that we use is association class, and the problem is again the mirror one. And so we have two operational entities, we have two policy entities, and this association between the two entities at the policy level. that time, so that sort of describes our policy. Any questions? Okay. So that's another kind of a target description, and this is how we describe sales. Okay. So we have again operational level entity which describes sales, and sales is like the number. Okay, and then at the policy level, we can define the so-called sales budgets. So what is interesting here? That the membership here, so you remember this is an event, and we talk that often we, so this is a grouping association, right? So different event instances are grouped together into different periods, and budgets are defined for periods. So what is interesting here, that here you actually you don't need an explicit association. You don't need to represent the association between sales events and sales budgets explicitly. Why? Because if you have a date of sale, which is an aggregate value of the sale, and if you have a time period described in the sales budget, you can always check which sale belongs to which sales budget, right? And this will allow you to calculate this derived attribute. So you remember, it's still, this is a grouping structure, right? So groupings use derived attribute. So derived attribute is actually the actual amount. The policy is the target description. So we will have a budgeted amount for sales. And again, we can calculate the variances from the budget. So that's another way to define policies. And again, what makes us different from the previous example, where we also had a target description. But here, we actually we don't need an explicit association. So although this is a basic one. Yes?
It's a normal project that growing form.
No, with a rolling forecast and rolling budget, what you do, you update it periodically based on what has happened so far. So it means that you are revising the policy. So in this case, that whatever calculations you do, it means that your policy revision will offset the update in this set.
Yeah.
But that's that you do this programmatically, right? So that thing is that's an example, and it's a procedure. You know, it's a procedural thing. So here again, the policies are presented declaratively. So we have data in the database that expresses the policies, right? So when you do those rolling things, you run a procedure that updates your description of the policy. And by the way, the beauty of declarations is that it is easy to update them. So when we have declarative policies, those policies will be easy to maintain because declarations are easy to change. If you try to express policies through procedural means, then if you want to update such a policy, you will have to change a procedure. And changing the procedure is much more difficult. Okay, that's also another example. Let me just try to wrap up because I know that I'm out of time. I have to give you a break, but still have another thing to cover. Okay. So, just to conclude, we use three, we consider three different kinds of policies, knowledge intensive descriptions, right? So, they can be inferred with the values. Another type is validation rules that describe the constraints and we can verify that actual happenings are within the specified constraints. And we have target descriptions that tell us what we expect or want to happen, and then we can calculate variances. Okay. So this is a possible way to describe policies in enterprise information systems. And I hope that you catch this connection with our modern technology of relational databases. Okay, now, so we had this discussion of some really advanced
modeling the search and graph information system. Now we have this methodological thing that will try to explain it. What we just started is indeed research. This is what puzzles many people, because accounting, traditional accounting research, usually meant something else. And in many other areas, research meant something else. So I'm covering basically one paper. This paper was published more than 15 years ago in one of the most respected information systems publications called MISQ, Management Information Systems Quarterly. And it was a very notable publication because the type of research that this paper advocated was actually not what MISQ was typically publishing. So information systems, the discipline of information systems, in the same way as accounting, actually mostly utilized a different research paradigm. But there were people who were arguing that other kind of research was absolutely necessary. Actually, some of it was taking place, but it was not clearly articulated, and therefore there was a lot of confusion. Some people even argued, so why are you doing this? Is this really research or not? Now, and this paper actually starts this discussion about the role of information systems in business, right? That actually they, information systems was viewed as a business discipline in contrast to computer science. That was a technical discipline, right? And as a business discipline, it really married certain technological issues with certain purely business issues like strategy, organizational infrastructure, and how it all maps to information systems. So information systems have to support operations of a business, right? So therefore, they have to be in alignment with what a business does. And this is basically just the basic idea of why we're talking about information systems in this context here. Now, as far as research methodology is concerned, the template for information systems, which belong to the category of social sciences, right? The template was always natural sciences. Sciences like physics, chemistry, and biology. So what is the objective of any kind of science? The objective of any kind of science is to understand how the world works. So what is the scientific method? Well, the scientific method is based on our empirical observations about the world. Right? So we actually try to observe or maybe say experiment with what is happening in the world. And then we would come up with what we call theories of how the world works. And then we have to justify that our theories are correct. Yes. Again, using an empirical method. Now, and this is what was copied by social sciences, with a major caveat that in contrast to natural sciences, social sciences dealt with the world that incorporated human beings. And human beings are very difficult things to study, right? So, because human beings are often unpredictable, right? We think, again, some people say that this is still a hypothesis, but most of us believe that we have free will, right? So this complicated things. But nevertheless, the research method was basically the same. So social sciences try to explain, understand and explain the world, right? So through the creation of theories about how the world works, and then testing those theories. At the same time, so if you look at the realm of natural sciences, you will see that there was actually a very important
application of what natural sciences have found out and the different kind of research. This is what we associate with the discipline of engineering. So, when people go to college and study engineering, they study a lot of natural sciences, right? So, if you're mechanical, electrical, aerospace engineer, right? You study lots of physics. If you're a chemical engineer, you study a lot of chemistry as well as physics. So, those people, they do study a lot of natural sciences, but what they do is different. Right, so the objective of engineering is not to understand how the world works, but to exploit the knowledge of how the world works to solve practically important problems. For example, how to build a bridge, or how to create efficient means of transportation, how to build a house so that down. And so people have been engaged in this different kind of research for quite a while. Later on, so when electronic computers were invented, so the discipline of computer science started developing very quickly. And I would argue that most of computer science, not 100%, most of the studies use the research paradigm very similar to engineering. Basically, to use our basic understanding of how the world works to solve some basic problems. Some people will argue that computer science also has its own science type questions. That's the reason why people distinguish between computer science and engineering. But if you look at the reality, the main things that people publish in computer science, of the same time as what we do. So what do we do when we do this kind of thing? Well, we try to solve practical problems by creating things that are useful for solving those problems, right? Very good. So, well, not necessarily things. We may create methods. We may create things, we may create methods, we may create different ways of viewing particular problems. So we have to invent something. And those things that we invent, they're man-made creations. This is what is called an artifact. An artifact is something which doesn't exist in nature. It's created by humans, right? For a certain purpose. Not just, you know, as an object of art, right? But for a certain purpose, bless you. So that's why we talk about the so-called purposeful artifacts. Artifacts that are created to solve problems. So when we engage this activity, we'll repeat it later on, but you will see it, that this is basically a cycle of creation and evaluation. So we build, and then we check whether what we build indeed solves our problems or useful for us. Okay. And we do this in this recurrent fashion. So this is basically the essence of engineering. Now, people usually didn't pay that much attention to these methodological issues. They just kept doing what they were doing because it made sense to them. Until fairly recently, I would say that this whole debate about design science is probably around, say, 40 years old. And probably the most important contribution was a book written by a very interesting person, Herb Simon. Herb Simon, some people call him the computer scientist. So he is definitely credited with the invention of some of the early machine learning algorithms, so I can tell you. system gets some work, which in our modern terms can be categorized as machine learning. He's also a Nobel Prize winner in economics. So he is a very interesting person, and he wrote a book called The Science of the Artificial. And basically in this book, so he argued for these methodological issues. So if you see that, so from Simon's book, The Science of the Artificial, is the cornerstone, this methodological development. And then later on, so people actually took it and ran with it. By the way, Herb Simon died more than 20 years ago. So I think the latest edition, the latest edition of the book is edition number 3, I think. If I'm not mistaken, it was came out in 96 or 97. So more than 20 years ago. He may have even died just before the third edition. So it's a very, and by the way, it's a really interesting book. If you have a chance, I would very strongly recommend it. Just read it. But then people actually started writing more specifically about particular areas of application design science. And Kerner's and Quarter's article is this application of computer science, design science and information systems. And I think that it's very useful as a methodological guidance for research that we have in account information systems. So those two papers that we, REA papers that we discussed so far, they are firmly within the realm of this debate. They are definitely examples of design science. Bill McCarthy's paper is cited explicitly in Kerner's paper. The second paper that we discussed with Gertz came out years after this. So obviously they couldn't sign that, but they signed some other joint papers of Gertz and McCarthy. So if you read it carefully, you'll see that. Okay, so what is the guidance? The paper actually goes in a lot of details to explain what kind of research you can do using this paradigm of design science, using design science and research and technology. So first of all, let's talk about the artifacts. So what are those artifacts? What are different human creations? And they categorize them into four categories: constructs, models, methods, and instantiations. Constructs, models, methods, and instantiations. And when you conduct design science research and create an artifact, it can be either one of those. So you don't really have to create four different categories of artifacts. Qualified as design science research. Any one of them would be a category of an artifact, and therefore, if it is useful for something, then it will be kind of design science research. So, constructs basically give you the language how to represent certain things. So, for example, let's say the language of calculus. When Newton and Leibniz designed actually mathematical methods, first of all, they came up with a new language that allowed them to actually progress. Then after they came up with a new language, they could develop other things, for example, models and methods. But if you don't have the language, if you don't have an abstract way of talking about particular problems, then you cannot really progress much further. So models actually utilize the language to express a formal representation of the world situation. So after we have the language, we can actually represent the world using this language, right? So in the realm of relational databases, entity relationship modeling is an example of models which is useful
for solving our, say, accounting information systems problems. So methods are specific ways of solving problems, or say, utilizing models to find, say, an optimal way of doing things. So this is what methods are. And finally, instantiations are particular implementations. When we take those things that we just discussed and try to implement them in the real world and see how they work. Okay. And there will be some discussion of what is new research and what is just practice, so we'll get to that. So, because when people hear about these instantiations, at times it may come suspiciously close to what the other people would call practice, not research. But there are maybe new instantiations which are novel. And basically, whenever you create any of this, it will qualify as innovative research if what you're doing is not obvious. If people, actually regular qualified people in the field, would not be able just to, off the top of their head, be able to do that, not to know about it. And so if it is obvious, it's not. When people, so here in the paper, they try to draw the contrast with the kind of information systems research which is conducted using regular social science methodologies. By the way, they talk often about behavioral things because to many of them, most of information systems research was behavioral. But it's not true because there was a fair amount of information systems research which is empirical, which is not behavioral. But it doesn't matter. I would say, instead of behavioral science, I would simply say social science. So the generic term here would be social science research versus design science research, right? And both behavioral and empirical are kinds of social science research, which follow the framework of natural science. So as I said, so social science comes up with theories and tests them, justifies. So design science creates artifacts and developments to show their usefulness. This is, so the goals are different. So the goal of social science research is the truth, right? So what is happening out there? The goal of the design science research is utility. Any questions so far? Yeah.
I was on a science has research seminar at St. Gallen last year, which is also another scientist in the field. Yeah, and said it's about design knowledge. So, of course, thinking that it has to solve a problem and it has to kind of activity. And said, so science and research is about creating design knowledge. But that's what he's saying.
Okay, now. No, the word design in English has two different meanings. Design, on the one hand, means what you create. This is the outcome. On the other hand, it also means the process, like how get the outcome. Okay, and when we do this design science research, actually, this would be the goal. So keep that in mind. So that there is this ambiguity, language ambiguity that we are facing. But I think that what you are trying to speak to is mostly related to this slice, which I didn't discuss. So here, on the one hand, so we have this environment, business environment, information systems, which deals with people, organizations, and technology, right? So this is what the environment of information systems is. On the other hand, we have what we call the knowledge base. So
knowledge base consists of what we currently know. And it is important for both science, social science, and design science, right? So, in terms of social science, what we currently know, well, there are two things, the foundations and methodologies. So, as far as foundations are concerned, so there are theories that we already have about how the world works, right? Frameworks, instruments. As far as design science is concerned, there are constants, models, methods, and sensations that we already have, okay? That people have already created so far. In terms of the methodologies, so there are already existing methodologies of data analysis. For design science, there already exists formalisms, methods, and foundations. So this is what we have. So when we do research, so our research has dual objectives. On the one hand, we have to solve business relevant problems. So what we do, you know, we don't have this abstract curiosity, for example, theoretical physics, people talk about the so-called string theory, right, the theory of the universe. As far as I can tell, there are no really practical applications. People cannot even foresee any practical applications, but that's still important because it affects our understanding of the world around us. So in the endeavors we engage in, there is no abstract things like that. So what we do has to have relevance to the existing business needs. Okay? So this is as far as the practical part is concerned, on the one hand. On the other hand, to qualify as academic research, we also have to contribute to the knowledge base of our discipline. So our research has to produce something that was not a part of the knowledge base up to this point. Right? Whether we are doing social science research or whether we are doing design science research. Right? So there is this dual objective that you have to keep in mind. Okay? So there have to be issues of knowledge base. So our research is based on our knowledge base. So it is informed by what we know, by the foundations and methodologies. But we also have to create something new that contributes to foundations. Okay, so this is the dual objective. Any questions? Okay, so this is just to summarize what I just said. So we, what we do, it is based on what we know, and what our outcome is evaluated. Those dual terms. Whether it is indeed useful and whether it expands. Okay, so this is a question which comes extremely often. So when people do some kind of design science research, one of the very common accusations thrown at them is that, okay, is it really research or is it practice? So what distinguishes design science research from design science practice? There are researchers and there are practitioners. And basically, practitioners, what they do, they use the existing knowledge base for solving the kind of problems that has already been solved in that way before. So if it is the same kind of problems that people have already solved using these methods, then there is no literature describing how to do this. And this is what practitioners do. Known types of problems using known methods. Now, if what you do is involves either a new kind of a problem, the kind of a problem that has not been dealt with here, or involves the creation of new ways of solving those problems, new methodologies, right? New constructs, then that's innovative research.
was this silly joke going on when I was a doctor student, when people were trying to say, so what is a doctoral dissertation? So and people said that, well, either you solve a new problem using some pretty well established methods, or you can solve an old problem but using some new methods. So that would usually be a good example of a PhD dissertation. And the question was, but what if you're trying to solve a new problem using new methods? People said, well, that's of course great, but that maybe you might try to chew, to bite off more than you can chew. So get your degree first and do those things later. On the record?
Yeah. I'm not taking credit, that was the kind of advice I got.
Okay. So that's basically the distinction. So if what you're doing is, if a knowledgeable practitioner in the field would know how to do that, that's not useful. So you have to create something new that has not been done so far. Yes.
Speak up. So social science, social science research. We sometimes have to look at the students, right? To see if we have different thoughts.
That's another debate, yes. And by the way, I'm very much in favor. So basically, yeah, replication research is very important. Unfortunately, it's almost non-existent in social sciences. So I can tell you that my background was basically computer science and natural sciences and engineering. I studied a lot of physics. Physics from day one. There is the first report of something. Nobody will take it seriously. Still, they publish 3 or 4 independent publications. Okay, and there are plenty of examples that people do something, get something, and then subsequent publications fail. And it's common. I mean, it's not like, you know, some people think that, okay, what you're doing, and if you fail. There was a saying in the old days. There must be an equivalent English thing, but there are the translation from Russian is only those who don't make mistakes don't do it. So the only way to avoid mistakes is to do nothing. So it's okay to make mistakes, but you have to have a mechanism in place that establishes this verification. So in social sciences, the general approach is usually when you extend something. You start by replicating what has already been established. So it should be a part of purpose doing other things. But what I'm saying is that it is important actually to have just replication studies. If for no other reason that, you know, times change, human behavior changes. So if there are certain things that have been established in social sciences in the past, it is not clear those regularities still hold. As a matter of fact, we know that in many socioeconomic systems, there is a constant change. For example, people who professionally engage these days in algorithmic trading. It so happens that because of my background, I have some friends who have been in those areas fairly early and still do that. I can tell you, they're constantly searching for regularity. So when you create a program that does algorithmic trading, so it has to trade to make money, it has to trade on certain regularities of behavior in the stock market. No, those regularities are fleeting. So you found something, you may be trading on it. A week later, it may not be there. Because everybody else started trading. Right? And the thing is. That's a very important topic. And there is, by the way, there are quite a few scandals with retractions in social sciences.
natural sciences as well. So we, unfortunately, in recent years, we have had some very unfortunate scandals where a significant number of papers were retracted. You know, at least in the natural sciences, you have this replication process. People can publish an article which is just an ad replication. Natural sciences, and it is expected, particularly. As far as I can tell, in social sciences, you're still, if you're trying to publish just a replication. Okay, there is this very interesting discussion, which actually relates to what I started saying. So the paper talks about the fact that the problems that information systems are dealing with belong to a category of so called wicked problems. So what makes them wicked? Well, a number of things. In many cases, the problem itself is not problematic. So people are not used to formal thinking. This is one of the problems when we're dealing with the human beings. Particularly those people who work with information technology, you know, often they interact with machines, and when they start interacting with humans, they often forget that human behavior and machine behavior are very different. And for example, machines only operate in formal terms, and humans have exceeding difficulty operating in formal terms. And one of the problems is our language, because our language is not a formal language. You know, there was a joke going on that, you know, that we have multilingual people. And so how many mega languages do you speak? Well, I speak quite a few. I speak English, I speak COBOL, I speak Fortran, I speak Java. There is a big difference. So natural languages are imprecise, they're ambiguous. There is a built-in ambiguity. So we as humans often resolve those ambiguities without thinking. The result is that we often deal with ill-defined problems, where, you know, the program is not stated formally, there is a loose set of constraints, there are different specifications that keep changing. So that's one problem. Another problem is that the systems that we are dealing with are exceedingly complex. They have a very large number of interacting components. So this is also most often it will mean that, you know, there is no hope to obtain, even if we formalize the problem. And there is a formal description, the problem is so complex that there is no hope of obtaining optimal solutions for those problems. So also we have to keep in mind that optimality often is not the right objective, because we have a play with the specification constraints. So we can actually move this problem in the direction that would make it easier for us to deal with it. So we have to keep that in mind. Now, humans, you know, many humans have very high opinion of Homo sapiens, but we think that we're perfectly rational beings, right? So there is a lot of research that shows that the vast majority of are anything but rational. They're rationalizing, that's a different thing. No, rationalizing means that you actually decide to do something, and then you come up with rational looking arguments why you want to do what you decided to do. So that's a different method. So we have cognitive biases. You know that there are all those things, for example, there are things like recency bias, so you remember better what happened recently. Other things. So therefore, humans are not really doing this. And we cannot eliminate the human. So when we say, you know, when we talk about any chain is only as strong as its weakest link, and very often in our socioeconomic systems, the weakest link in the chain is the human. Okay? So all of this makes this very difficult problem to solve. So and when we do design science, so we have to keep that in mind. So the paper basically presents the following 7 guidelines on how to do design science. Okay, so the first one says that design science is an artifact. So what is an artifact? So it's an innovation. So this is, as I said, something that will actually affect how we do things. So allow us to solve certain particular problems. As I said, so it can be anything. It can be a construct, a model, a method, or instantiation. Instantiations are important. Until we create innovative instantiations, we don't really know if any of those artifacts will work. And as I said, so it has to be non-obvious. Okay? It has to be valid. So it has to be a relevant problem. Now, here there may be some argument. And occasionally, you will get into the debate whether certain things are relevant or not. So academic researchers have a problem here because very often we are distanced from practice. You know, you cannot really be both at the same time. There are people who actually do consulting and have more engagement with practice, but many academic researchers have this distance. So therefore, in some cases, relevance may be imaginable. In some cases, you run into that. So there are some papers that I wrote where actually one of the arguments of reviewers was that, you know, we don't really think that this problem is that relevant. You're trying to solve it, but for whatever reason, we don't think that it is really that important practice. And then you really have to make sure that you can argue that. This is an essential part of design science research. If people will say, well, I mean, there is no flaw in what you're doing, but what you're doing is completely irrelevant, it will shut it down. So it means no goal. So that research won't work. So recently, I can give you an example of this in practice. So I have a paper on how to try preserve the confidentiality of audit client data, and at the same time to take advantage of the knowledge of this data when you audit some competitors. Okay. So it's a tricky development, and one of the reviewers said, well, I mean, there is no, it's not really a relevant issue what you're trying to do because, say, public accounting firms actually do this. And I know for a fact that they don't, because there are rules of professional conduct that prevent them from doing it. So even if you, as a public accounting firm, audit, say, 2 different banks, and one of your engagement teams has information about the results of operations of a certain bank, but those results are not disclosed yet. You are just auditing. You cannot inform the other audit team, even though it's in the same public accounting firm, of those results. So that is currently prohibited. Okay, so, but this goes to the, what we are doing in our paper, we are actually going around. So we're coming up with certain creative methods how you can still get some information without actually making any particular disclosures like this. And the reviewers didn't argue against our methods, so they didn't find any flaws with our methods. But one of the reviewers said, well, I don't think this is that. So exactly for this reason. If that argument stands, our paper goes down. Because this is absolutely right. So that's the argument that allows you to come. So it means that when you do this research, you cannot be too divorced from practice. So that's why, so you know that we have car lab, we have different projects in the car lab. So that's why all those car lab projects are so important. Even if they don't directly, say, to a new research publication, at the very least, they develop your awareness of what is actually happening in practice. and you cannot be successful doing this kind of research if you are ignorant. You don't really know what is going on in practice. So this is one of the challenges. So it is not present in many other areas, but it is a critical issue. So, and as I said, so yes, you have to create an innovative architect, but if it is not relevant, it doesn't matter. Okay. Any questions? Okay, that's another thing, a big one, the evaluation of your architect. In the early days of design science research, there were examples where people proposed something. Said, look, I think this has to be done this way, and this is a great idea. And you can actually refer to some publications 20 years ago when such kinds of research would fly. It absolutely will not fly today. So if you are doing any kind of design science research, an absolutely critical thing is to prove your artifact. So that you claim that it can be useful for something, then you have to argue, show how it is useful for something. So, and what it means that you have to evaluate your artifact. So, how do you evaluate it? So, there is a great table in this paper. If nothing else, I strongly recommend that you make a copy of that table and keep it somewhere, because it shows you a wide variety of ways how you can evaluate your artifact. So you do have a very significant flexibility how you argue the usefulness of your artifact, show how it is valuable. You can do it in many different ways, as I say, so you check functionality, complete consistency, accuracy, performance, reliability, usability, fit. As a matter of fact, when you're designing an artifact, you will see that there will be this loop between building and upgrading. Because our research is usually an iterative process. So we don't just come up with an artifact that does what it is supposed to do. So we make numerous attempts. So we have some ideas, start doing it. And when we're doing it, so it has to be a part of this evaluation. That shows that, okay, so this is how we're doing this, this is how we're going to do this. Okay. The table that I talked about is this. It is called design evaluation methods. So there are five categories of design evaluation methods. So observational, analytical, experimental, testing, and descriptive. Yeah, so I reiterate, it doesn't have to be all of them. It can be any of them, right? So it is up to you to choose which kind of evaluation you are going to do. And as I said, any of them may work, but the objective is to be convincing that you're evaluating, that the way you evaluate your artifact is indeed useful to something. So, observation. So, it can be either a case study or a field study. A case study would not be as different from instantiation, but you are actually looking at other people instantiating your artifact, right? So, what is a case study? And then actually using this. Or you can propose a way to instantiate. It's not clear how to instantiate. And again, you can use a case study to show that it works. A field study will examine multiple approaches where people actually use this artifact in multiple ways. Then, in some cases, some artifacts actually can be evaluated analytically. So this doesn't happen often because in many cases, what we're dealing with is too complex. But in some cases, say, if a model or method that we propose is not exceedingly complex, that we may be able to do some kind of analytical formulation. So we can check the so-called static qualities of that. Or we can check how it fits within general architecture. Or we can show certain optimal behavior, of optimality and so forth. Or study the interaction, the dynamics of the artifact. So as I said, so in some cases those analytical methods work. So it can be experimental. So either we create a controlled environment and conduct an experiment to see how the artifact behaves, or we can use a simulation, very popular method, where we create artificial data and check the behavior of the artifact with the artificial data. Okay, so this is our experiment. Then we can do the testing of the artifact. We distinguish between functional testing and structural testing. Functional testing is basically an input-output relationship. So it's also known as a black box. So why do we call it? Black refers to the fact that there is a mechanism. It is in the box, and you cannot see inside. So that's why people call it the black box approach. But basically, it refers to the input-output relationship. So basically, you can observe what goes in, then there is something, some kind of processing that happens inside, and you can observe what goes out. That's why it's called functional testing, because what is a function? Given the argument of the function, you know the value of the function. Y equals f of x, right? So this is the definition of a function. There is also the white box, and again, white, again, it's the wrong thing. I would call it transparent. So what is important is not the color, but that you can see inside. Okay? So, but those are already established terms, but I think that the metaphor is not correct in this case. So because you are really talking about the transparency of the box, whether you can see the mechanism or not. So, and when you can see the mechanism, then you can you can evaluate the structure of the mechanism. So you can do this testing and see what is happening with different parts of the mechanism. What is engaged, what is not engaged, what is engaged under what circumstances. Okay, so this structural testing of the artifact. This also can be a kind of and finally, there can be a descriptive evaluation. So you can provide, say, an informed argument, a reason that supports the value of the artifact, or describe the performance of the artifact in different business scenarios. Okay? So as you see, there is a multitude of methods that you can use for the evaluation of the artifact. And it is up to your creativity which of those methods to choose. Okay, but you have to choose something. If you don't do this, these days you're not gonna have a paper. Design science. So design science papers will require evaluations. You don't just propose and say, I think this is a great method. Okay, why? They show how you evaluate. Yes.
So the last part is, do you think a design science research paper today will kind of buy the argument of an informed argument? I mean,
depends on what it is.
Yes, but I mean, this was proposed in 2004, and so much research has been done in this area. I mean, at least you need to kind of get real problems.
Again, I say that in some cases, probably that's a serious. Depends on what it is. But I can tell you that no matter what, there will be a lot of pushback. So this is, you know that when we try to publish our research, so there is this double-blind refereeing process. And it means that we don't know who the referees are, but usually the referees don't know our identity. Having served in the role of the editor and senior editor of major publications, I can tell you that a lot of referees are very harsh.
States or Europe, and I get very, very, very confused, and there will be a lot of pushback pretty much on everything. Starting with the problem, with the way to solve the problem, how to evaluate whether not just about the other evaluation means as well. I won't believe, for example, how many runners of questions people raise about simulations. As they say, well, it's really a realistic thing, but if you're getting more than one with artificial data, is the creator of artificial data to share something that you created, then one of the accusations is that you know you really created your artificial data in a way that is beneficial to your method. And it is on you, the burden proof is on you as a researcher to argue that no, actually, that I create my simulation data in a fair way. Otherwise, you know, it's. So, on the other hand, if you try to use real life data, not simulated data, real life data, then often pushback is that and again, you're doing something, you're playing something, but this actually applies what you're showing in your evaluation, it applies in this case. But you are claiming much more than just this case. Okay, so again, this is really a critical part of the paper. So when you're doing this research, it should always be in the back of your head. How do you go about evaluating? So, depending on what kind of artifact we create, different evaluation methods will be more or less appropriate. There is no doubt about it. Yes, it is very much artifact dependent. Yes and no, not always. So, in some cases, as I said, so when you're doing a case study, this is a very close association. But say simulation is not. Analytical arguments usually are not. So no, not necessarily. Speak up, because if you go, people have to hear not only me but also you.
I'm wondering if the loss function in machine learning has to be
No, the loss function is a metric. Loss function is a method. So if you are, say, if you are creating a new machine learning algorithm, right? So you're creating it for solving a certain problem, right? So the ultimate evaluation of the artifact will be the future use. Okay? But that you cannot do because, well, you can see it, for example, you're creating it for certain business scenarios, maybe a business will start using it and telling you what the results are. So that would be closer to instantiation and say a case study to show that it works. But very often, what we do when we use machine learning algorithms, we do some kind of a simulation study. So, or we do some kind of cross validation. Okay, so. You see, the thing is that one of the things that what you bring up here, so say in machine learning, the results may depend on your choice of the loss function. Right? So as we discussed in the machine learning class, so you can use different loss functions. So in general terms, when you're dealing with design science, when you're talking about the artifacts, there is this question of metrics. So what kind of metrics you choose the evaluation of your artifact. So this loss function example from machine learning is just a special case of the metrics. And again, here you have to make sure that you choose those metrics appropriately. Because there may be a pushback there as well, that you know you are presenting these numbers, but you're not really measuring what you should be measuring. So what kind of metrics you choose when you evaluate your artifacts.
So that's, again, there are multiple issues. And every point, sorry. The good thing is that you have this flexibility. So you have many different ways how you can go about evaluating your artifact. You know that other people may be willing to accept different evaluation methods. But you have to be as convincing as possible when you do this. And this is an absolute must, so you cannot forget about it. Because, you know, very often when people do this kind of research, so usually, initially, most attention is focused on this, how to do this, how to create an artifact, right? And often, in the beginning, people ignore the issue of valuation. But it will come up again. There is no doubt about it. Okay? Other questions? Okay, so research contributions. So clearly, as we talked about it, so when you do design science research, your research contribution is an artifact. So it should be, it should allow you to solve problems that people couldn't solve before. So it should be based on the existing knowledge, but it should be implemented, but it should expand the knowledge, right? So it can contribute to foundations. Right, so novel evaluations, or it can be, say, new methodologies. So, for example, if you come up with a new convincing way to evaluate certain types of artifacts and new methods, this is a very important methodological contribution to design science research. Hey, in some cases, actually, people do this. So, they propose different ways and say one of our main journals, Journal of Information Systems of the American Accounting Association, has been publishing and will be publishing methodological papers. Okay, rigor. That's another very big topic. And this is a challenge. So when we do academic research, our objective is to be as rigorous as possible. So we have to state what we are doing very precisely. We have to use rigorous methods, preferably with methods. And we have to argue how we actually do this based on what we have done. So now the problem with this is that for very difficult problems, for the wicked problems of information systems, rigor can often in conflict with relevance. It's like, you know, and by the way, this problem is not unique to design science. It is also a problem in social sciences. For example, people usually think that economics is the most rigorous of all social sciences. So there is a famous saying, a very well-known economist, I don't remember whether it was Samuelson or somebody else, who said that, you know what, no economic model is really correct, that they are all oversimplifications of reality. But some economic models are useful. Okay, so, and that's a challenge, because if you are trying to be rigorous, be able to come up with rigorous ways of solving certain problems, often it requires you to oversimplify the problem. If you try to represent all the complexities of the problem, then there will be no rigorous way of solving it. So this is the art of modeling. How you can actually do something which is still rigorous and remains relevant to the extent. So, if you don't, then what you do will be completely useless. Okay, by the way, economics is often a target for them because they, indeed, these days, it's mostly mathematical economics, right? And therefore, people emphasize the reader a lot. But when they do this, they have to make so many simplifying assumptions, okay, that the end result will be completely irrelevant. Okay? By the way, there is a very old joke about this, about, you know, that a ship sinks, and three scientists end up on a deserted island. And one of them is a physicist, another one is a chemist, and the third one is an economist. And they're starving, there is nothing to eat, they cannot find anything that grows on the island. And all of a sudden, you know that there is a shipwreck, and some things actually are washed on the beach, and they find a can of food. But they don't know how to open. So there is food in the can, and they have this problem, this predicament. They don't really know how to open. So, and they try to use their professional qualifications to come up with a solution. And the physicist says, you know, we are on a tropical island, so it's really the sun is shining brightly. Why don't we leave this can exposed so the sun will heat it up to lead to the increase in the internal pressure in the can as it will heat up? Maybe that internal pressure will burst it open. And the chemist says, well, you know what? We are on an island in the tropics. There is this ocean around us. It's salty water. Why don't we put the can in the water? And maybe that this corrosion, the can will corrode, and we will just actually break it open that way. Then it is the economist's turn, and he says, okay, so let us assume that we have a can opener. So, again, listen. I started economics a while ago, great respect. This is a problem. Design as a search process. So, as I said, so our design process precedes iterations. So when we are trying to find a solution, okay, so usually you can represent this as having something called a solution space, right? When we're talking about machine learning, so we have the space of hypotheses. Here, there is a solution space. And when we are creating our artifact, what we are doing, in fact, we are searching through this space, trying to find the best solution possible. And then we can use different search heuristics, different ways of searching through this space. So, and we can try to do it again, iteratively. So try a solution, test whether it works, see if we can modify. So like local search procedures in the space, right? So all we can do, try to do some other search methodology. But basically, this is a useful analogy. So to think about it as a solution, to think of a solution as a point in the space. And we are somewhere, we are elsewhere in that space, and we can find our way towards the solution. So there is this generated test cycle. There is a discussion that Simon. Okay, now when we do this search, the objective, the target that we want to do is the end, so the end point. So it's useful. And when we try to get there, we can do certain things. So those are the means. So you know, so we have the end objective, we have the means, different actions or resources that we can use when we construct our project. Right? So and what we do is constrained. Okay, what we do is constrained by the environment, by the laws of nature, the forces of the environment. Right? Now and as we progress, so our knowledge and our understanding of the ends, the means, and the laws is constantly refined. So we make it more and more realistic, right? So in this way, we improve the artifact that we are trying to construct. So there is this debate of designing an artifact as a search process. So maybe a useful guidance, methodological guidance when you do your research. Now, there is this thing. Yes, we want to have a very clear understanding of the ends, the means, and the laws. The problem with the wicked problems is that it may not be possible. Okay, so that the size and the complexity of the problem will complicate so much that we will not be able to find the best artifact computation. So it may not be computationally feasible. We will talk more about that in machine learning. But there are certain problems that we cannot solve because we don't have enough computational means at our disposal. And this is not a temporary restriction. There are problems that are intrinsically computationally difficult. It means no matter how powerful our computers will ever be, those problems will not be solvable computationally. Not in the sense that there is no algorithm for their solution. An algorithm may exist, but the amount of computation required may be, for lack of a better word, astronomical. And so there is something called the theory of computational complexity that shows you that it is not really about any particular computational technology. No computational technology will allow you to solve certain problems. For example, if your algorithm has the so-called exponential complexity, if the amount of computation grows as an exponential function of the input, no matter how fast you will ever make your computers, if your inputs become sufficiently long, you will not be able to solve it. Because, for example, you can show that with any computational technology, the estimation will require longer time than the age of the universe. Okay, so that will tell you that it is not solvable, right? So there are ways, there are cases where we cannot get to the problem. So in this case, and it is very common in design science, and by the way, in other things as well, it is very common to resort to heuristics. So what is a heuristic? A heuristic is a way of getting a solution which is not perfect, but maybe good enough. We call it an approximation. Okay. So very often you're going to use those approximations. By the way, not only in this general discussion, you will see that when we later talk in machine learning, we'll talk about using computational heuristics in machine learning. So there are some arguments that, so you know, I talked about optimization problems in machine learning. Very often, some of the simple heuristics work better than even what you can find if you say solve it optimality. And this has to do with imperfections of our models. So our models may not be exactly correct. So therefore, trying to solve exactly a model which is inexact, it defeats the purpose. And the heuristic may be even better in terms of. Okay, finally, your paper has to be well written. You can't imagine how many poorly written papers I had to referee in my professional career. I can tell you, you're not going to earn any brownie points. So you have to properly communicate your results. In this area of design science, you have multiple objectives. You have to communicate your results for the practitioners. So you're creating a practically useful artifact. So your results you have to present them in sufficient detail so actually practitioners can reproduce it. If you don't present it in sufficient detail for practitioners to reproduce it, then it is not a good presentation. It's not enough to publish it. So you have to present it so that you convince your peers, your researchers, that you have real innovations. And finally, since we are dealing with business entities, there is this always management. It's not just the practitioners should be able to implement the artifact. You have to convince the management that it's
worthwhile. That you know that the benefits exceed the costs. So there are multiple objectives, but there is no doubt that if you don't present your results well, you're not going to get any publication. Now, the reviewers will be very upset if you have to referee the paper, which is poorly written, both in terms of the language, in terms of the logic, in terms of the arguments. You know, it is on the authors. It is not the job of the reviewers to rewrite a paper for the author. So several times I had to referee a paper which was so poorly written. So granted, the authors were not native English speakers. I'm not a native English speaker either. But you know, I sent them back saying that, you know what, before they do anything else, pretty much every sentence in this paper has to be correct. So if that's the case, that's not a good presentation. Now, take notice when you submit your coursework. It's the same thing. Your instructors will not appreciate it if you don't really write it. And again, different people have different abilities, but this is something that has to be invested in. Okay, so communication of research results is absolutely critical. Any questions about this? Okay, so this is the final slide. Okay, so research guidelines. So, just to summarize, first, the utility of the article, then, the evaluation to show that indeed it does have this utility, to show that it is relevant, that the existing artifacts don't solve the problem. No, you don't need a new artifact to solve a problem that can be pretty well solved in other ways. So, again, as I said, this rigor and relevance. So, you have to show both. So, if it is not rigorous, then there is no reason to believe that it actually does what it is supposed to. So, if it has no utility, then it's solved the problem, it is not needed. If you don't demonstrate this utility, you make no. So that's a quick summary. So there are there are some challenges. This described 6 years ago, I think they still apply. So there is a problem with the existing theoretical basis. It's very difficult. Very difficult to develop an adequate theoretical basis. It keeps evolving, keeps expanding, but this is still a challenge. Okay, if we want to be absolutely rigorous and very abstract, then we will be criticized. That it's not relevant. It's not useful for the field. If we are trying to be very relevant, then we might not be rigorous enough. So that what we present may be too formal. Okay, so there is, as with any research, you know, we try to present it in a very logical, top-down way. But the truth is that very often we rely on our intuition, on the trial and error approach. And it's very much bottom up, but it doesn't mean that we should present it more logical. Now, in many areas, it is perishable. That's another thing. So, when you're dealing with information technology, so it, well, the world outside changes in general, but this area changes particularly fast. So, and you know, I've been around long enough to have observed multiple cycles. Of things becoming relevant, and everybody is interested, then people losing interest, then start doing something else, some other things becoming relevant. And very often, by the way, in this area, people have friends invent new terms. Okay? But still, you have to find the rationale. Okay, so Enrique is difficult and not general. Okay, I'm almost out of time, but I still want to make a spiel about the recent publication. So, we published a special issue for Counting Horizons, which is a journal of the American Accounting Association, which is designed to bridge the gap between accounting academics and accounting practitioners. Basically, to showcase accounting research, which should be of direct interest to practitioners. efficiency. So we had a special issue of Accounting Horizons devoted to the current developments in audit analytics. So there is, you know, auditing is changing. So auditing is working more and more with digitized data and relying more and more on analytical methods. So we pulled together the whole issue of Accounting Horizons, where different articles showcase different analytical methods in audit. And we decided to write an introduction to this issue that made the, would draw attention of the accounting researchers to the fact that design science is a really critical and important research methodology. So we wrote this paper called Audit Data Analytics and Application of Design Science Methodology. And basically the points that we are making are the following. That first of all, accounting by its very nature is an artifact. It is a human creation. It is not something that existed before humans invented it. Okay? So that already should give you an idea that maybe design science should be an appropriate methodology for accounting in general. And by the way, today, if you look at the reality of accounting research, it is social science 99%. Okay? So it's mostly empirical research, it's not going to be behavioral research, but there is very little design science research in accounting. Accounting is an artifact. Okay? So what is auditing? Auditing is about assuring the quality of accounting information. How do auditors assure the quality of accounting information? By using what they call audit procedures that allow them to gather audit relevance that will prove the accuracy of accounting information. So what are audit procedures? And there are many different types of audit procedures. Well, guess what? Audit procedures are also artifacts. They are human creations for that specific purpose, okay? So therefore, we make an argument. So that design science is the appropriate research methodology for creating and evaluating audit procedures, okay? And as a matter of fact, if you look at the auditing literature, 30 and 40 years ago, there was some kind, there were some publications in auditing literature that used design science methodology implicitly. They didn't use that terminology. But if you look at the papers themselves, what they were actually design science papers. We are talking about papers on analytical procedures and papers on sampling. So if you look at those early papers where people actually work on developing new analytical procedures and new sampling techniques, and they were published in the 70s and the 80s, those were in effect design science papers. And what we are saying is that since then, auditing research unfortunately moved away. You can find very little in accounting and auditing journals about developing new audit procedures. And the reason is because they actually they didn't do that, and therefore they didn't use this design science methodology. And this is the methodology for this task. So if people want to create new ways of doing auditing, they have to use design science methodology. And there are examples. So then in that paper, what we do, we actually show that those papers that we present are indeed design science papers. Any questions? Okay. You are done with me. So from this point on, you will see some other people in this class. Okay, and I will see, still see some of you in my machine. Okay? So you're going to switch it off, right?
Yes.